What is poppin', everybody? My name is Justin Woodward, co-founder of Black Voice in Gaming and The Mix, as well as one of the advisors on the Black Game Developer Fund. I'm gonna tell you a little bit about Black Voice in Gaming. Black Voice in Gaming is a nonprofit organization that was created to inspire and cultivate talent, as well as help video game developers and creators have opportunities for funding, discoverability, marketing, visibility for their games, and just network in the culture of game development. This show is really, really awesome. We have awesome guests, awesome games that we're gonna be sharing with you guys. It wouldn't happen if you guys weren't checking us out. Also, shout out to all of our sponsors and the folks who are broadcasting this event. Check out the Steam page, follow us on Twitter, all of those things. And that's it for me. It's all about the games, it's all about the developers. So take it away, Destinee and Derrick. It's gonna be a great show.
Thanks for the intro, Jay. What's up, y'all? As always, it's great to be back here co-hosting Black Voices in Gaming, especially during the celebration of Black History Month. I'm always honored to help showcase some of the best talent out there. My name is Destinee, and I do a lot of stuff. But one of the things I'm most proud of is being a host here and over at Level One Gaming, a minority-owned organization that focuses on gaming, news, entertainment, and all things geek culture. Today, I'm happy to be sharing hosting duties with a super talented person. I'm going to toss the mic over to him so he can introduce himself.
Thank you, Destinee. And I have to agree with you. To be back on the digital stage for another great show is so exciting. I'm thrilled to be here during Black History Month celebrating some excellent developers. Hello, everyone. My name is Derrick Fields. I'm the founder and game director of Waking Oni Games, as well as an advisor to Black Voices in Gaming.
Now, before we start, we want to give a shout out to our partners for today's showcase. First, I'd like to thank our silver sponsors for their support. PlayStation. Listen, I remember the first time I got my PlayStation. I had the PS1 and I still use my PS3 to this day. You can't tell me anything. Also, Xbox. I love my Xbox. Xbox Game Pass. Give me all the games. Riot. What would you do without Riot? Listen, it's in the name. Like it says excitement. So thank you to all of them for being silver sponsors. And we also want to thank some of our fantastic other sponsors who have been with us since the beginning. Raw Fury, who helped get this series started from it becoming a showcase to it being a nonprofit organization. We'd also like to thank Razer and Wilson Socini. Listen, I think I got that right. It kind of just rolled off my tongue. Derrick, did I get that right? Socini?
You nailed
it. Yeah.
You're
good.
Thank you.
I feel like I should have like a pasta and wine because it sounds very Italian. But if it's not, I'm sorry. But it does. It just sounds so good. All right. Also, let's jump into our bundles because this is the first time I think we've ever had something like this happen. And if we haven't, forgive me, but this is the first time I'm aware of it and I'm super excited about it. Amazon is supporting us by creating a Black History Month bundle just to celebrate Black game developers throughout their Prime Gaming bundle. And listen, all of these games are so incredible. You have to check them out. Not only is Prime and Amazon helping us, Amazon Prime, but Humble Bundle, who has continued to support us and our devs, they're putting together a bundle. And listen, when I tell you they're putting together a bundle, you better believe that they're gonna have some incredible games in there. And they're all doing this to help celebrate Black voices in gaming and just Black developers in general. So we just wanna say thank you so much for actually taking the time to put this together. It's really, really important. And I hope everybody grabs their phone because you need to go ahead and grab those QR codes. Like I know your phone is sitting right beside you. And if it's not sitting beside you, you're scrolling on it. Get off of TikTok and grab those QR codes. Now, I know I've said a lot and I just have a few more things to say because we cannot end this without saying thank you to our wonderful broadcasting partners, Twitch Gaming, IGN, Steam, GameSpot, and GameJolt. And speaking of games and Steam, don't forget to check out the Mix Event page where you can learn more about Black Voices in Gaming and about the available games. You can add them to your wish list. Remember, that's super important. It always helps Steam's algorithm. It makes us know that the games are on and popping and they're super popular and people are excited to get them. So remember to wish list. It helps the devs a lot. And Derrick, I know I've talked so much and I know you have some stuff you want to tell us. So please, please indulge the people.
I do. While you're enjoying the content provided, we are always encouraging that if you want to support Black Voices in Gaming, the best way to do it is to head to our Tiltify. That's your chance to donate and help support the developers who are being accelerated through programs like these.
Also, we have some merch. We're not wearing the merch right now. Listen, we wanted to, but mine's in the wash. And Derrick's is, I don't know where Derrick's is. I think his is on his son somewhere in the ether. But listen, we have merch. So, you know you want to wear Black Voices. Have you seen our logo? Have you seen the design? What are you waiting for? Make sure that you go check out our merch because it's absolutely incredible. And if you forget, don't worry. We'll remind you again later in the show to go check it out. So, yeah. Derrick, what else do we have for the people?
Lastly, you know, you need to follow us on social media. So remember to check out Black Voices in Gaming on Twitter. That's BVIG, BVI Gaming, as well as Black Voices in Gaming's YouTube channel and Instagram.
That's right. There's no excuse, guys. We're on all the best social media platforms. So make sure you check us out. Now, with all that being said, I know we just threw a lot of information at you, all important though. But I know what you really came here to do is to get some gaming and to listen to some people talk about how they've created these amazing builds. So I'm gonna introduce our first guest. Listen, guys, I'm super excited about introducing our first guest. He's amazing, incredible, and he has the dopest sweater. Not that I saw him before, but we are going to be bringing up Jace Boucher with his game, Little Hellions. And before we get into it, we're gonna show you the trailer. Get ready, y'all. It's a rocking time. God, that just totally reminds me of like when I used to sit and do couch co-op with my little brother and like play all these games. And the music, oh, I think I said it before, but like it gives me the vibes of like when I was sitting there watching Transformers the animated movie for the first time. Like the music is jumping in this. And listen, I'm super excited to get on Jace, but first, before we bring on Jace, Derrick, what did you think about the trailer and what do you think about the game?
This is bringing out the metal lover in me. So while the trailer was going, I was just over here like air guitaring and rocking out. I'm excited for Little Hellions. So like, bring it on. Bring Jason here so we can learn more about this game and I can watch y'all play.
Yo, Jace, are you in the building?
I'm in the building. I'm in the house.
What's
I'm here.
Up?
Hello. Hi.
Welcome, welcome.
Happy to be
here. Huge shout out to your sweater, by the way. We love it.
You.
Like the whole vibe you've got going. But Jace, we just saw the trailer. Absolutely incredible. Can you tell our viewers a little bit more about you and your journey and kind of what influenced you to make Little Hellions?
Oh my gosh. I'm Jace. I've been working on Little Hellions since 2015, which is a really, really long time for a person to be working on a video game. I'm a solo developer, so I basically learned how to be a game developer over that period of time. I started it, like I said, 2015. It was a global game jam game, and the theme for that jam was, what do we do now? So the core idea of the game, both mechanically and aesthetically, comes from that. Like, the game is about zipping around the screen and being anywhere on the screen at any one moment. What do you do now? And then it's also about the underworld. You're in the underworld now. Eternal damnation. What do you do now? You probably chill out and eat pizza. Probably.
Listen, I love pizza, so I would probably be doing that if they allowed us to do that in the underworld. Absolutely.
Yes.
But, you know what, Jace? One of the things that we did talk about with your game is that it is co-op, right? So, like, if you have a friend and it's you guys and you're, like, sitting there, you can play it together with your friend right beside you. And I definitely miss that because I feel like a lot of games don't do that anymore. So we're going to jump into the game, and Jace is going to come in the game with me and play it with me. And listen, guys, I know I talk a lot of smack about how great I am at games and how I'm, like, the absolute pro. But Jace is definitely going to put me to shame. But to be fair, he's the developer. So, okay, if it was anybody else, I'd be amazing at this game. But while I'm getting all set up and we're picking our characters, I'm going to throw it over to Derrick so he can ask you some more questions.
Yes, yes. I want to know more about Little Hellions, specifically the art direction that we saw in that trailer. Can you tell us more about what inspired, the look and feel of this game?
Yeah. When I first started working on the game, like in that game jam, for instance, I'm just going to get out of the menu here. I basically just had a character, like Lucy, the little red character there. She was the first character that I thought of for the game. And then I was like, okay, what would be the world of a game that would support this character? And then The whole game kind of arose from that. Where Lucy came from was, like, you know, a bunch of inspirations. Like, I think I was kind of into, like, what was that series? Disgaea. I was kind of into that at the time. I've always had, like, a from a distance fascination with the Guilty Gear franchise, so like kind of heavy metal, kind of like meets anime kind of thing. And then the rest of it was just like, I like Sonic, or at least I have a relationship with the Sonic franchise, I suppose,
right?
You could say. So a lot of the aesthetics kind of are drawn from like Sega era stuff, and yeah, it's kind of all over the map.
Good. No, I think it's breathing those aesthetics. Yeah.
Like, we're not even in the game. He's like kicking my butt. All right. I'm just running around.
How
and
the
like...
game works, huh?
Yes. Yes. Let's do that.
Yeah. Before we get too far in here. So basic. So this is like the lobby, right? And so what you can do is Little Hellions is a fighting game. It's like a party fighting game. But the core conceit is that you can't attack at all. There's no way to actually fight. So what you can do is you can throw this hook out and grab your opponents. So your goal then is there's a bunch of traps in the levels and you want to throw your opponents into the trap. So I would like say grab Lucy and chuck her into the trap. It's got like a lot of like nuance to how the hook works. Like, for instance, if I'm close to Lucy, I'll barely throw her. Whereas if I'm far away, I'll like catapult her. And then there's kind of a rock, paper, scissors mechanic on top of that, where you have this shield. So if you try to use your hook when your shield is up, you'll get parried like that. And there's a bunch of like little nuances, but there's very few actual core mechanics. Like, that's pretty much it. But how you use those tools is very, there's a lot to learn, you know. And it's got a weird menu system, as you've noticed.
Yeah, you can, I was like, I'm just like jumping around and stuff.
you can swap with the person who's controlling the menu and be a little goblin. So that's like what that whole thing is. Let's get into it.
Sounds like we have built-in troll systems. Yeah.
Including gameplay in the game menu is something that we don't often see done. So shout outs to tossing that in there.
We never would have started if you left it up to me. You've just been in the menu the whole time.
That's the menu thing is that I really need to make a good tutorial because people it is a weird game to pick up because you're like, well, how do I fight? I can't punch, you know. Here we're the trap in this level is just the lava pit, really straightforward, and you just want to throw someone into the lava. There's items,
or just have them walk into the lava
or anything like
by
that.
Themselves. No, I really love, like, okay, so can we talk a little bit about the aesthetic and the art? So you've been working on this since 2015. Is this all you? Like, the art, the characters, like, give us the lowdown.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, so... So yeah, I've done everything. That's why it's taken so long. The only thing that... It's easier to say what I haven't done. So what I haven't done is the music. The music is licensed from Stryker and TWRP. And got a pretty full soundtrack. And then some of the background art, not all of it, for instance, this background I did, but some of the background art is I work with a guy for and we go back and forth on. But other than that, like all the character animation, all the programming, all of the level geometry, you know, everything, game design, it's all me. And that's why it's taken so long.
Of course.
I mean, it looks really good, though. Like, it looks so good. The color, the character, I really like the character design. That's like super cute. Well, one of the things I noticed is like there are pieces of candy falling from the sky, and I love myself some candy. But like, what importance does that have in the actual game?
So the candy is imagine like Smash Bros. Meets Mario Kart, I guess, for the candy. So it's like they're items, but you'll get a random item depending on the category of candy you eat. So the pink candies are like attack offensive items. The green candies are defensive items. And the yellow candies are like special items. Oh, I just ran.
Wait, so
anytime
am I seeing
guys,
this correctly?
Literally.
That the level wall, you can walk to one side of the wall and you'll come out the other side of the
Yeah, it's
the
got
stage.
Pac-Man
yep.
rules, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So on this level, you have this big death wall that moves around, and you can just stand on these buttons to move the wall around. So a lot of the level's traps are also interactive. Oh my gosh, I'm like right on the edge there. you can actually control the trap utilize it, right?
Oh, so, okay, I see that.
Yeah, so I find when people ask like, okay, what kind of fighting game is this? Like all the characters play the same. There's not unique abilities for each character. So when it comes to matchups, you're almost like learning how to play each level more than you are each character, right?
Yeah. And, you know, speaking of that, could you tell us more about the levels? Like, what other traps or stages are players going to be expecting to confront with?
Yeah. Well, there's four worlds in the game, and each world has about six levels. I'd like to add more post-launch when that happens, but you know, as of now, that's where it's at. And yeah, each world is themed around, you know, like a series of traps. So the first one is Schadenfreude. That's like the city of the underworld. It's kind of like your basic levels that are just kind of help you understand how to play the game, like lava and bomb pigs, which is like the mascot of the game. He's my son. and then there's the boneyard, which is like a big scrapyard of bones. We actually just saw that. All the traps in that series of levels are about kind of like movement and big machines that move you around. here's a good one as an example. And then there's Stabby Land, which isn't in the early access build right now, but it's like a amusement park. Yeah,
good
it's
name.
Like a it's like a sadistic amusement park, and it's all about kind of like moving the player around. So there's like springs and traps like that. Oh, geez, we both just got hit by the train.
Oh, there's a train. Oh, this level. This is challenging.
They did not expect that.
Yeah. And then the last one is Dread Noodle, which is a Lovecraftian under the sea ramen nightclub. Like, it's like a million things at the same time.
And, okay.
That's just got like. It's got a lot of unique traps, I guess. It's kind of like a combination of all the prior levels. It's kind of like the advanced stages, I guess. Mm-hmm.
That's exciting. Yeah, these are so fun to look at. Seeing that train come through is intense.
No.
We're really good at this. But that's the thing.
I'm really good at dying. Yes.
The game is there you go. It's like it's simple. There's not a lot of moves and stuff, but it's like it does require skill to pick up. I think it has kind of a happy medium between being simple to play and having a very high skill ceiling. Like you can really like get good at it. That's kind of my goal. Actually, speak to that. One of the mechanics, we can't actually see it here because we're playing one-on-one, but if you're playing with four players, there's this mechanic where when you die, you turn into a ghost, and you can keep playing. So if you die and you're a ghost, what you want to do is kill somebody else who's live, and you'll come back to life. So you always get to play the game.
Oh.
The idea there being like, I'm terrible at Smash. So... I just spend half the game watching everybody else play because I'm dead. So Hellions kind of lets you keep playing even if you're not particularly good at the game. And I think the exciting part of that is for, kind of advanced players. That's actually like kind of a good thing too, because the intensity of the match is always at maximum because there's always four people around. Even when they're dead, right?
I love that. And I love the fact that you've actually thought about that and implemented that into your game, because nobody likes like dying and then just having to sit there and not be able to join in on the fun. So that's really, really cool. We're actually rounding up at the end of our time. But before we go, if anybody wants to find out more about you and your game, can you drop your socials? Where can we find out more about you?
Yeah, the best one is probably my Twitch. I stream every Monday and Friday game dev. So like if you want to see how the game is made, how the sausage is made, et cetera, you can see that. That's twitch.tv/onionprofessor. And then I'm on Twitter, but you know, the trash fire that is Twitter. I'm also on there at Professor Onion, so it's the flipped around version of it. Those are my primary ones.
Nice. Well, Jace, thank you for taking some time to come on and show us Little Hellions, and you know, not pulverizing me too much in the game. I appreciate that. I cannot wait to pick it up. Guys, if you liked what you saw, make sure you go over to Steam and wishlist it. It means so much to the devs and so much to the community. And yeah, Jace, thanks again. Totally. I'm excited. Please tell me you're releasing the soundtrack for this game, because it's dope.
And, on that note, you can actually play the game now. It is in early access too. So if you want to just play, you can do that. It's in actual early access, not like early access. So it's not done, but you can play it if you want.
Well, you heard it here, folks. Now you have no excuse. Go get the game. Go check it out. And
check it out,
Jace,
and rock out.
Thank you again.
Yeah, thank you.
We'll talk to you soon. Bye.
Wow, that was incredible. I was getting, you know, like the Schadenfreude crowd of, you know, watching y'all play and missing out on some of it. So maybe that's where some of the name, you know, like sitting on the couch and mm-hmm. experiencing other people play. Really thoughtful, you know, studio name and gameplay. But we are about to head over to Island City, and that's Distraction Machine, where we'll be talking with Latif Martin about their game. And so stick around, because we have more gameplay, more talks coming at you next.
Can you play something for their friends and family? Distraction machine. Will it save our people or lead us to ruin?
Wow, that was cool. I'm so here for the artwork and what's coming together for Distraction Machine, but let's bring in Latif. Oh, I'm sorry, Des, what did you think about the trailer before we bring in Latif? I got so excited. I'm just like ready to jump right in.
No, I thought it was really cool. It seems to be set in this kind of dystopian world, and we're seeing if music is going to be enough to kind of bring us out of this chaos that's happening, this distraction machine. So I'm really excited to talk to Latif and get to know more about kind of like the journey and the story of Distraction Machine. So yeah. Latif, are you with us?
I am indeed.
Welcome. Hi.
Hey, what's going on? Great to be here.
It's nice to meet you.
Yes, me nice too. To meet you. It's so good to have you here. You know, could you tell our viewers, you know, who you are and a little bit about Distraction Machine?
Yeah, so I am a multidisciplinary artist. Best way to handle all my ADHD. And the creative director of Miscellaneum Studios. I founded the company back in 2013. And we're a multimedia company. And Distraction Machine is a music composition game where you create music to uplift and inspire your community during a zombie apocalypse. And actually, the game is based on a larger world. It's based on a comic book series that we publish. I am the co-writer and illustrator of the comic. It's called Zile, and the comic takes place 7 years after, and Distraction Machine is actually the prequel. So the comic book is already out. We've had copies. We've sold them in stores and whatnot and conventions, and decided, you know, as a multimedia project, you don't want to tell the same story on different platforms. So we figured, okay, zombie apocalypse 7 years after, because most zombie stories happen at the apocalypse. We figured, what is it like when people grow up? Like, what is it like when kids grow up in that world, in like the zombies, the undead is their reality? How do we explore that? And then I wanted to tell the story of what happens before the comic book series. So that's what we did, the game.
That's incredible.
That's so sad.
I was going to say, you know, I can't wait to ask more questions about the art direction. But, you know, as we jump into the game, I was going to say it feels like a moving comic book in what we saw in the trailer. And so, yeah, I just want to see y'all play. I'm going to be here for moral support and to see what we're going to get into here.
Cool. So yeah, I'll walk you through a little bit, because it's you know, just obviously this is still a demo, so there's a lot of little things that you might not get right away because the functionality isn't all there. But yeah,
listen, so, I'm just hyped that our main character right here is a woman and a woman of color. Like, absolutely mm-hmm. love that. I want to see that in more games. So I'm really excited that you have that. But yeah, let me go ahead and go through some of this script. I was going to read it and like try to do voice acting, but I'm not going
to
do that.
Oh, no, I'd love you to do it. It'd be great.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
This isn't your VO debut. Sean...
All right. So we have a small window to distract them before too many catch our scent. Kalu threw a mobile machine together for you. Doesn't have the bells and the whistles of your setup in the lair, but it'll do. Now get on the truck and lead that frenzy away. All right, Shonda, we're ready.
Yeah,
so
that was good.
Thank you. What should I pick first? Like, wait, what? I barely know what I'm doing, which is me. That is me. So I feel like that's the one I should go with as I try to save people. But just to, you know, give everybody a look, the other options are, what kind of beat should I use? I will build a soundscape these rabid ghouls cannot ignore. That was nice. But we're going to go with what? Game,
yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No worries. No. So, you know, throughout the game, you have 2 to 3 options to respond with, and the dialogue choices help guide your journey. There are 4 different endings to the game. So depending on what answers you reply with, it'll lead you down a certain path. And the 3 different ways that you can play the game is either of a more communal vibe, or more of a survival instinct, or more of a fanatic. We're not going to tell you which dialogue choices are which, but for example, Shauna is a community-based, as you can see from the logo right beside her name. It's the logo for community, and the idea is that, you know, you're giving, exchanging, and it's an infinite circle of giving and taking. So that's what that symbol requires, or rather represents. So, but yeah, I mean, go with whatever one you feel.
Yeah, I'm going to go with this one because, having everybody depend on me, it's a little scary. Look, we don't need a 5-part magnum opus. Just make as much noise as you can. That I can do.
All right.
So, okay. What should I play? Or I'll do, you know what? I'm going to go with I'll do my best because I will. That's all I ask of anyone. All right, Shauna. Ask the fighter guarding the truck for some input. They know the feeders better than anyone. All right. Long live the fighters.
Long live the fighters.
And she said, yeah, sure, just go. Dang, Shauna, wait.
She
didn't
match
we were on
energy.
The same page. Yeah. All right. Get going. I'm going. Okay, so Ahoy, who are you? How do you say his name? Hidavar?
Hidavar.
Hidavar.
Interesting story about that character, so I'll tell you later. Well, I can tell you now, just really quick. Hidavar is a character that actually exists in the comic book series, like 7 years after the story. And when we did the comic book, we did a crowdfunding campaign, and people, depending on how much they gave, became characters in the comic. So we would give people a character profile form to fill in. What's your name? What are your strengths and weaknesses? What weapons? And this person came up with this character called Hidavar, who is basically a dude who exists as a Viking within the world. And so I decided he's such a cool character in the comic. Let's see how he started out in the world of the Straction Machine. So super cool.
Oh, that's dope.
Yeah.
I love that. Yeah. So like when you're playing this game and you start off, do you go through each character's dialogue that's on the screen?
Yeah. In this case, for example, like, you know, when a person has a request to help them on their missions, there's criteria. Mm-hmm. And there are different people that will give you criteria. So this is where we're at now, where we're getting criteria from the crew.
All right. So this is Hidavar. I'm not even going to try to do a guy voice. All my guy voices sound like stoned, like surfers or something. I don't know. I can't really do very good ones.
So you hang out with stoned surfers. Okay. That's all good.
Yeah. You know, Cali life. Ahoy, who are you? Okay. So I'm running the music box thingy. I'm just passing through. The temp bard, and I am the one they call Distractor. Who are you?
Love that.
I'm gonna go with the first one. Bah, bards are good for nothing but victory songs. All right. Shauna wants my help. Will, enough with your witless prattle, bard. Dang, no, these people are mean. Okay. These unholy abominations swarm to the sound of a heartbeat, so use drums. Okay, that makes sense. Cool. All right, so next I would click on
talk to her. You're talking to Naila, yeah.
Okay.
Naila the bladesmith. She has nothing to say. She is not interested at all.
She's that tall, she's that strong, mysterious type character that you see in anime. She really had nothing to say, okay.
Word.
Bomani?
Yeah,
am I saying that right? Okay.
Yes, you are.
You've got some big beats to fill. I hope you're up to, I hope you're up to the ask. Or task. I didn't say ask.
Same thing, actually.
Yeah. I'll give it everything I've got. That might not be good enough. Wow, the pessimism. I'm going to do my best.
Maybe a zombie apocalypse world, you know, comes with a lot of pessimism. You might be the
I would think so.
Drop in the ocean right now.
I don't even know what I would do in a zombie apocalypse world. Make music, maybe. Uh-huh.
Also, we'll give you a little context. Also, just quickly give you a little context. So you're the newcomer. You're coming in as the new distractor. Their distractor sacrificed their life to save you. So basically, you're coming in as a new distractor. Like, okay, who are you? I don't think you can do the job. So everyone's like, okay, dude, or you know, any.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense, especially if the guy they knew before, like you know, sacrificed their lives for me, and they're kind of like, you know, I could see that. Feelings are hurt. All right. I bang my chain rings together when hunting feeders. Really gets them riled up. Use a percussion like a shaker in your music box. Okay. All right. So now after I've talked to everyone, what's the next step?
So now you go to your music box. You go to the distractors layer. So the music box icon is the one to the right. To the far right. Yeah.
This one right here. Okay.
No, the diamond.
This one. Oh, the diamond.
Yeah. Go down and go to the right.
I see it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So now you're on the truck. And so now you see you have your criteria. You have three criteria to fulfill. You've got your music box, which has four spaces in it. You have different music boxes throughout the game, different sizes, different types of different shapes. And you have your inventory of instruments on the side here. So basically at this point now, it's about filling up your music box with instruments.
Okay. So I know someone said something about drums. I'm just going to pull some stuff in. I'm put that in, baller, and... this and can you use like two of the same, or is it better to use as many different?
But it might be yeah, you could, but it might be a good idea. So right now you wanna you know, Bomani suggested using a percussion instrument. So I would say you can take out the one of the horn gardens.
Okay.
You take it off, and then you can go to the menu here and go up and down, and just the button here, up top, the down
up
button
top?
Yeah, so the one just below, right there, yeah.
Got it.
So you're going to go down, and you're going down to the oat shaker down there. So you can grab that.
So that would be considered
that's literally
percussion.
My breakfast. That's a can of oats that I took, and I shook, and I sampled for the game. All these instruments are actually
so
based
cool.
on real-life instruments. Yeah,
okay,
so
cool.
All these instruments that's are based dope. On instruments I've built or have sampled in the studio.
Which is really, really cool. And I think we're going to talk about that a little bit because you have some in your background. But all right, let's make our first beat so we don't get eaten, because that's what I'm worried about. I don't want to let these
you're
people
not quite down. Finished. You're not quite finished because
everything
has to be connected with chains that lead to the crank. The crank is the heart of the music box. So you're going to go down to your menu. You're going to go down first to your batons, your noisemakers.
Because you have a
noisemakers is the second button. That one there.
There we go. Right?
Yeah, so you're going to grab one of the noisemakers. I suggest either Kalu's Mallet. Actually, Moko's Brain Piercer would be good as well, the one on the bottom. And so each of the noisemakers fit in the nodes. The nodes are the spots at the corners of the frames. But as you can see, the logo here matches the logo there. So you want to drag it where you see the noisemaker logo icon on the music box. So you see there's four of them there. There's four kind of red circles that are...
Yes.
Kind of shimmering. So you want to drop it on
right
one of them.
Here.
Yeah, perfect.
There we go.
Cool. So now that's the only instrument that needs a noisemaker. Next, you got to connect them all with chains and the cranks. You want to go down to the drivers on the menu.
Okay,
the
third button, got it.
Yeah. And the crank,
and
you can put the crank anywhere you want. And grab the crank.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I can put the crank anywhere. So I can put it here and we're good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah, that's going to be interesting. I would suggest putting it in the middle because that way everything can reach it. Right in the middle, right center of the frame. So like one spot down.
Right here. Okay.
So now you're gonna connect it in with chains. So you're gonna drag the chain onto an instrument and then drag it to the crank. There you go.
Okay. And so right here?
Yep, you can drag it there.
And
nice.
Put another one right here. Oops, right. Nope.
That's good. You got it. It's there. Just drag it.
Oh, okay.
It's kind of behind everything. So just, yeah, just go, yeah. Just drag it right mm-hmm. from there to the crank.
Oh, you know why? Because that is not, that yeah, wasn't a thing. That's why.
And
okay.
You can still drag it because it's there. So you can just drag it from the middle of that wheel to the crank. There you go.
There we go.
So now everything's connected. You can see in the corner the criteria, all your criteria is fulfilled. You could submit request. You can submit request, but you could also work on some music. So for now, you can do a little mm-hmm. preview. You can grab the crank and spin it counterclockwise, the other way around. Yeah. And then you can hear a little preview how it sounds. You can just let go.
Oh, word.
Right.
Oh, right. That's kind of dope.
Yeah, yeah.
So now you're okay. going to the center button up top, which is the composer. We're going to open up the composer. Each instrument okay. has its own Each instrument has its own default loop, and it also has its own loop library. So now you have the play sheets. Each instrument has its own sheet of music. So the bar here, you see the bar that kind of curves at the top. You can drag your mouse along up and down the bar.
This one?
Right to the right. Right, the bar that's vertical, like the silver bar here. Yeah. On the bar itself. Yeah, yeah. You can
on the
go
bar
up and down.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, right. okay. Yeah. I see that.
What
yes.
What you just did by mistake, which is actually really cool, is you hit the trash can icon and you deleted all the notes that are on the sheet. But you can add your own notes. No, it's perfect. You can add your own note. Or
okay.
Drag it down a bit. Drag the sheets down a bit, so you can see the title. Mm-hmm. Click on Oat Shaker, the word itself. Oat Shaker doesn't have any loops. You didn't add any yet. But if you go to the bass Lethalium, for example, the next one up, that has a bunch of loops, okay. right? So you can add your own loops.
So these are already okay.
The goal for us is, like, no matter what your music proficiency, you should be able to create music that's fun and easily. So there's a bunch of loops. You can mix and match. You can write your own music. So there's a bunch of different types of styles of music. I have a background in music, so and I've jumped from scene to scene, from hip hop to the industrial nights. I've gone to, like, you know, raves and whatnot. So there's a lot of different types of genres of music in there to play with. So
yeah. Oh, I wish we had more time to be able to experience Distraction Machine, because it seems like that there's so many excellent parts that need, you know, their own window of learning curve but time to explain, so that sort of people can really dig in, because it sounds like, just on the information that you've given us so far, there's really a lot of expansive gameplay, and I'm excited to be able to hear it all come together. We're unfortunately out of time, but before we're out of here, for those who are out there and want to learn more and want to dig into those details, where can you tell people to find out more about Distraction Machine, and how can they get the game?
Cool. Yeah. Well, our Steam page is up, so if you like it, please wishlist. But yeah, we're looking to release our game sometime in the summer. Pretty much that's it. And there's two sides of the game. There's Chronicle mode, which we are playing right now, and there's Conductor mode, which is endless music creation. So that's the mode of the game where you can just make music, and you can save it as a file, as a sound file, or you can actually save the song, send it to your friend who has a copy of the game, they can open it up and remix your song. So it's really about sharing your creations.
Cool.
We want to create a community of distractors around the world, and I'd love to hear what people are coming up with. Funny, I don't know if you saw it, but the trailer for the Tetris movie came out about how Tetris is created, and just recently I did a remix of a Tetris song with the game. So I'll send you guys a link about that, and you can take a
look. Yeah, please do. That's dope.
Incredible.
Yeah, just to say real quickly, where you were at the game, at that point, you could have hit submit request. And when you hit submit request, you see how the music affects the mission. So what would happen? You submit request, the music plays, and the scene plays out. And whether if you follow
the criteria. I actually did.
Yeah.
I actually did hit submit. And Shauna said not too shabby. So I'm kind of proud of the work we did here today.
Yeah.
Good.
So yeah, you can either help or harm the community based on how well you follow the criteria. That time, you save the day. Shauna said, not too shabby, everyone saved. If you didn't follow the criteria, people would have died and it would have been your fault.
Wow. So much to dig into. I'm so excited.
You heard it here first.
Yeah, I want to thank you again for being able to join us today. It's been exciting to get to see bits and pieces of Distraction Machine, and I'm just looking forward to more.
Thank you. Yeah, I can't wait for people to play it. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
We'll see you around.
All right, ciao.
Wow. So, I mean, I'm enjoying that. Des, you got to dig into it, and I hope it drew you in. But, you know, for those of you who are out there, if you too are enjoying what you're seeing so far, please consider supporting the developers through Tiltify. Donations to Black Voices in Gaming go toward our mission to helping game studios and game studio entrepreneurs succeed. And so while you're at it, you know, making those donations, supporting the developers, you can support them another way. That's the Steam page. Go to the Black Voices in Games Steam page to wishlist any of the games on today's show, as well as many more. We encourage you to do it right now.
Yeah, go wishlist. It means so much to them. But you know what? We're going to keep it going. We're going to keep it going because we have our third guest who is coming up. The voiceover Finiciato? It doesn't matter. She's amazing. She's incredible. Queen Naveen, who is voicing our girl Layla in Redfall, is up next. Let's check out the trailer.
Let's.
It's red.
Play it day one with Game Pass.
Yo, I remember when that first aired last year when I saw it, and I got super excited because I saw a Black female character and she was just bad to the bone. Like, she was incredible. And so, Derrick, tell me, how do you feel about Redfall? Like, are you ready for it?
Yes and no. Look, I am a big fan of immersive sims. I love the stuff that Arcane puts out specifically. Prey and Dishonored are huge for me. And so when Redfall's trailer came out, it was the same vibes. And we got to see the character on screen, Layla's amazing hair, like everything's perfect. I'm so excited for it.
I mean, like, you took the words right out of my mouth. But listen, what's even more exciting and what's even more incredible is that we have Queen Naveen, the wonderful, the amazing, incredibly talented voiceover artist who is Layla in Redfall. Queen Naveen, are you in the building? Are you here with us?
Hello, yes I am. Thank you guys so much for having me.
Oh my God. Thank you. It's a pleasure. I was about to say the same thing. Thank you for taking time out of your schedule to be a part of this and help us celebrate Black voices in gaming. And you know what? It kind of like fits, right? We're talking about Black voices in gaming and you're a voice actress and you're doing your thing out there and you're basically holding up this whole representation that we really want to see, like the diversifying of the game industry. So let's kind of delve into the story of you. Like, have you always wanted to be a voice actress? How did you get into this?
Actually, I didn't even really know what voiceover was when I was younger. I started in theater, in live theater, and performing and plays and stuff, and did that all the way up until college. But throughout my life growing up, everyone's like, you have such a great voice, you should try voiceover. So where I took acting classes, they had a voiceover class. Finally decided to jump into that. Took that for about a year, and after that, I signed with a voiceover agent, and my career kind of just took off. So voiceover kind of snuck into my life, but I really like what I've done so far and where I've ended up with voiceover. So yeah, it's kind of like a natural talent I didn't know I had, and I'm using it to the best of my ability.
That's what's up. And you do have a great voice. Like, you have a wonderful speaking voice. It's very like melodic. I'm pretty sure that's a word. I need to just make
Thank
that
you.
Up.
Yeah.
It's very melodic and I love it. But like, I don't want to ask all the questions because I will. Like, I could talk for hours to you just about everything. But I know Derrick has some questions too, so we're going to go back and forth. So I'm going to throw it to Derrick. Derrick.
Cool.
What's up? What do you want to ask?
I mean, there's where do I begin? You know, you shared right? a little bit about you know, how you jumped into voice acting. You know, let's talk about Layla. You know, that's what brings you here. And so, what was it like to play as Layla? Was this your first video game character role? But you know, give us the details.
Yeah, so I've done a few video games before this, and stepping into Layla actually was not that hard. I pretty much easily related to her. I mean, one, she's a black female, I'm a black female. We both have like that poofy kind of curly hair, same kind of facial features, and just the personality and who she is. She's very sassy, she's smart, she's got student debt, I got student debt. So like, it was so easy to jump into her and kind of just bring her to life, and I really enjoyed recording her lines in the studio, and we always had a lot of fun. So I'm really excited for this to come out and to share Layla with the world.
You really embodied her. Sorry,
I was just about to say that. I learned from that was that you are Layla, and Layla is you. So, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
I love the part about student debt, because I was like, dang, we're still worrying about student debt with the vampires right. and everything, which seems very, very realistic, honestly.
They made her very realistic, yes. Yes. I was like, good job. Good job.
Yeah. Right. But not only that, like, I just want to give a shout out really quick to Level One Gaming, because they're the ones who kind of put us in touch with you. And like, yes. I know when I sat back and I watched that that whole interview, I was like, dang, how'd they get her on there? That's so incredible. And so when we were doing ours and we wanted to diversify it up, we were like, I have to have her. And when Derrick messaged me, I was like, I'm going to see what I can do. I have the perfect person. And so it was just, listen, we were so excited when you were like, yeah, I'll come on. And this is something that I want to be a part of. And like, just thank you so much. You know what I mean?
Oh, because, well, thank, like, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely incredible. And before I throw it back to Derrick, I know you've done voiceover work, but I know you're also doing other things. And I think that's really important for like our viewers and our listeners to see that like, it's not just voiceover, like you use your voice in so many different ways. And you recently just did something that was really incredible that I saw on Twitter. So can you tell us a little bit about that? Cause that was really cool. Kelly Clarkson, hint, hint.
Yes. So first of all, yes, shout out to Level One Gaming. They are amazing. And thank you so much for them putting me you in touch with me. I'm so happy to be here. But yeah, I got to be the live announcer for the NFL Honors. So basically, that's like the Oscars for the NFL that they have every year. And it was held in Phoenix, Arizona this year. I headed out there. I was able to walk the red carpet. I was there for 3 days of rehearsals. Got to meet Kelly Clarkson herself, and she's the most down-to-earth humble person, like celebrity, that I've ever met. I mean, she just hugged me, came right up to me. She was like, oh my gosh, I've never met someone as short as you. You're as short as my mama. And I was like, yes, Kelly. Yes. But she was amazing. Voicing the NFL Honors was amazing. I'm not so much into football. My fiance had the best time of his life because he knows all these football guys. So I was like, this is really for him. You're welcome. But yeah, I had a great time doing it. It was such a cool experience because I haven't done an award show where it's based on just sports like football. So that was definitely something cool that I got to add to my books. But it was an amazing experience, and I'm glad I got to do it.
That's up.
So exciting.
I know when I saw it, I was like, you did a little clip, and I was like, she's so excited when she's doing, like, the energy that you put into it is just, like, absolutely incredible. And I know, like, that's something that you have to keep up, even if you're not feeling like you're super energetic. And I think one of the questions that Derrick had put down was, could you talk a little bit about the challenges that come with a role like doing voiceover work and things like that?
Yep.
So for voiceover, specifically, let's say you do like live announcing. Live announcing, there's really no room for mistakes at all. So you have to be on top of it. You have to be able to take change on the spot. You have to be brave and courageous because you're live announcing a show that millions of people are seeing at the same time. And you have to be on the ball. So it's very nerve-wracking for a lot of people, but for me specifically, it's thrilling. I thrive in the chaos. I love it so much. So it's awesome for me. But when it comes to like animation or video games, say, you have room for mistakes. You have room for to do new takes or figure out a new way to say this line or that line. So you have room for imagination, basically. So the room is basically yours. You can play around, have fun with the character. I want to make sure I got your question right. What are the challenges you had said?
No, yeah. That was great.
Okay.
That was really good because I'm thinking like, yeah, if you're doing something live, I know when we did the live Black Voices in Gaming, I was so nervous because there's no like, hey, let's do that take again. Right. Like it's just, if you flub up and you just keep going. But like, part of it is like not making a big deal that you made a mistake because usually people don't catch on to those mistakes. It's in your head how big it is. So
you have to not get worked up in yourself. Exactly. You have to just be able to improv on the spot. If you make a mistake, pull right back to it. Like, so taking improv classes as well definitely helps with that.
Ooh, yeah.
These are some good tips. Derrick, what do you have?
No, speaking of tips, for those who are out there listening to this interview and feeling like video game or voiceover or cartoon voiceover, any other aspect of it is something that I want to jump into, what would you say to somebody who is aspiring to start a career as a voiceover artist?
So this may sound like a generic basic answer, but it's very, very important. You have to take classes. You have to know what you're doing before you jump into a career that you don't really know much about. So taking classes basically will teach you the basics of voiceover, the terminology, techniques, how it all works. You have to really know what you're doing. And that is the first step in getting into voiceover. And from there, they can help you create a demo. They can help you submit to different agencies. So I think taking classes is definitely an important step into getting into the voiceover world. You have to also be able to network with people because Hollywood is all about networking. So you have to get yourself out there. You have to submit. You have to go to these workshops and these classes and these events and conferences. I mean, if you want to be in voiceover, you have to be all in it. There's no halfway or I'll try a little bit and see where it goes. You have to be all in it. So it definitely takes time, energy, money, sleep. But take care of yourself. And if you want to do it, go for it.
Yeah.
I love that. I hope you guys are listening. Like, it's going to take some work. Like, this is not something that's going to happen like overnight. And I think a lot of people think just because they have a microphone and everything, they can just like go for it. But like, I love the fact that you also brought up networking because a lot of people will talk about, you got to go to school, you got to take classes. But not only that, you have to network. And networking is, I think the seed of networking starts with the people that you're in class with, right? Like, you just never know. Yeah. Who's going to meet someone else. So like, for example, everybody knows Justin because Justin is the one who kind of helped put this together. But I met Justin in college. I used to like hang out at his place and I've definitely crashed on his couch before. And like to see how far he's come to putting something like this together, it really is. Do not look at everybody as your competition. That is what I'm going to say.
Yes.
Please learn how to network. That is so important.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
I agree. I'm so glad that we highlighted, you know, how to some of these important values in getting involved. You know, certainly the role of a voiceover artist, as much as other careers relating to and not when it comes to gaming should not be minimized to just hop in and then you're done and suddenly monies. It takes a lot of effort and planning. Speaking of planning, do you have any goals for the future, especially when it comes to being a voiceover artist? Does it involve more games? Does it transcend to, or not transcend, but transition into cartoons or animation? What else is on deck for you?
Well, I have two goals that I've always wanted in voiceover. So the first one is to be on the Disney Channel. I love Disney, everything Disney. I would love to voice one of their animated shows or Pixar as well. Pixar and Disney being one of their animated movies. I would love that. I mean, this is my only tattoo. So
yes,
it has to be Disney. Love everything Disney. So that has been my goal since day one. So definitely still working towards that and working on that and hoping to make that a reality very soon. And then my second goal is live announcing, continue live announcing. I told myself I wanted to live announce an award show at least once a year, to have at least one show to do once a year. And lately I've been very thankful and grateful to be able to get more than that. So I definitely want to stay on that path, stay on that road. Again, like I said, I thrive in the chaos. So I want to keep doing live announcing shows and to try my skill at different kinds of shows as well. Just like sports was my first one at the NFL. Would love to do more. So, yeah.
I think that's incredible.
I'm excited. Yeah. I'm excited you mentioned- for you. And I know you're going to reach those goals. Absolutely. I'm sorry, Derrick. I keep cutting you off. My bad. Go ahead.
It's all good. We're all excited. No, you mentioned the Disney Channel. I can't leave this conversation without at least chiming into that old "you're watching the Disney Channel" moment where they had the celebrity and like trace the Disney logo.
Yes, the wand. Yes. I always practiced it. I was like, I'm gonna get this mouse right. I got it, guys. That's how it goes.
So we give you that motivation as we you know, conclude our conversation for today. Just, that's gonna be what you'll do with Disney.
Yes. That's going to be the end goal. I'm ready for that. As you were talking, this is super random, but like you gave me, like, I love Cree Summers. I know she's done a lot of the black voices and ethnic voices, but like you gave me Maxine vibes from Batman Beyond. Like, just listening to you talk, I was just like, I could totally see it. If they did a reboot.
I've gotten totally that before. Yeah.
Week. Yes. And I wanted to be her when I grew up. That's not happened yet. But I could totally see you doing that. But you know what? I'm just so in awe of all you've done. And I don't know how many people tell you that they're proud of you who you've just met for the first time, but I am very, very proud of you and what you've accomplished, because I feel like so many little girls like myself and like you, we grew up and we wanted to be these things and we wanted to see these things and we're out here doing it. And that takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of dedication. So from one creative to another, I appreciate all that you've done. And again, I just want to thank you for taking time out of your schedule to come on and talk to us about your journey and about Layla. And guys, don't sleep on this game. Definitely get the game. Even if you're terrible at it, like, just get it and support and just be a part of it. I mean, like, I know I'm terrible at first person shooters, but y'all already know which character I'm playing. So.
Right. Yes. Same though. I'm going to be playing Layla.
Yes. Well, thank you guys so much, of course, for having me. I'm just glad I can be someone, a woman of color especially, to open those doors and pave the way and being inspiration for younger kids and anyone else who wants to get into this industry, that you can do it too. We can break these barriers. We can be leads in video games. We can live announce award shows. We can do anything. So I'm here to help. I'm glad I can pave the way for all of you guys. So let's get this.
No, that's what's up. Layla, if anybody wanted to find out any information about you or if they wanted to continue to follow your journey, where could they find you?
Anyone can find me on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, Twitter, at Queen Novine. I'm here and I'm available. You can also head to my website at www.queennovine.com. There I have a lot of information on my backstory and my journey and what I'm up to coming up soon, and as well as voiceover tips. If you're looking to get into the industry, I have a lot of tips on my website. So hopefully that can help you guys. And let's chat.
Awesome. She didn't notice that I called her Layla. That's because she's the same character inside and out. So she just went right with it.
I was like, no, I love that too.
I was like, is she going to notice?
I didn't notice that.
Wow. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you for coming on. We really appreciate it. And guys, please go check out if you're interested in becoming a voiceover actress. Like, that's my new goal now. Make sure you check out her website and follow her journey. She's incredible. And yeah, we can't thank you enough for coming on with us today.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you. Take care.
That was a great interview. Like, I'm so like just touched. Like, I feel inspired.
Right, right. So I heard tidbits. You said you now have a branching path into voiceover. Is when are we starting? When are you jumping in? Voiceover for Distraction Machine, and clearly this is just the beginning of it.
That is true. It's just, you know what? It's gonna happen. Like, right after we wrap up the show, like I'm just gonna like find some classes I'm gonna do. I really think I'm gonna try and do it. I think it'd be really fun. But yeah. Guys, before we move on to our next guest, don't forget to check out our Steam store and wish list some of the games that you've seen today and that you've seen on our past shows. Honestly, it helps our developers so much. It lets Steam know that their games are up and coming and popping and people really want to see them. And so, you know, that just creates a better future for all the algorithms and all of our games, because they're all dope. They're all amazing. But yeah, I'm going to throw it over to Derrick so he can introduce our next guest. Guys, I'm just really hype coming off of that interview. I'm sorry. Like, you know, just roll with it. It's cool.
It's all good. Next up, we have a couple trailers to share with you first. First, a new update from New Challenger's tactical beat-em-up, Treachery and Beatdown City, scheduled to launch on Xbox on April 27th. The Ultra Remix update packs a punch with 3 times the amount of content, free to existing owners on PC and Nintendo Switch starting in April. This includes, but is not limited to, 8 new maps, over 80 new enemies from fascist cops and preppy cyclists to affluent punks and even ninja terrorists. You try saying that list over and over. All new attack moves, defense gameplay mechanics, and more music.
Yeah, I was gonna say something about that. I was like, that was a tongue twister. I don't know if I could say it. So I think you did a really good job, honestly. But next up is Ukungu. And listen, I had to look that up because I did not want to say it wrong. I actually had the whole team look it up because we wanted to make sure we got it right. But Ukungu is a fantasy adventure indie game currently in development. This game is a fast-paced action RPG spotlighting Blacks and Africans taking on lead roles in the story. The trailer coming up will give you a peek at a number of different enemy encounters, beautifully rendered environments, multiple combat styles, and a brief glimpse into the deep lore surrounding the group of truth seekers. Now get ready to check out these trailers and stay tuned for more info on our bundles, Tiltify, and our socials.
Moneybags News Network proudly presents your number one source for your current events. Of course, with a little of my comments every sprinkled in. Oh, we got a guest today. Before I bring him in, Beatdown City still wildin'. Run by some tyrants whose lifestyle found us. Law enforcement so childish. Knowing it's wrong, but they won't do a damn thing about it. President's gone, a victim of kidnapping. We keep screaming and still nothing happens. Man, it's driving me insane, making me wanna up and suplex a train. Anyway, when we get back from the break, we gon' meet someone who has something important to say. So grab a little snack or something cold and just cheer to the next episode. Come on.
Revolution! Untelevised tonight, cause it's money bag news with the lies you like. Look at the bad news flying on a Friday night. If you call it bad news, you're right. I'm providing the coverage for once. Tired of rubbish, and my foes getting wise to the lies they publish. Conflicted interest, some conundrum. They run from the source where the funding comes from. You know what really grinds my gears? When the president disappears, ain't nobody saying shit is weird. We gon' make it all crystal clear with baseball bats, chips, and spears. I got the key to the sun to beat down. Rage unlimited, reach down. I'm standing on mine to be down. We can be down. Raw to a pull apart. Mess around there, find out Boulevard.
Thank you. light low, moon high. I can see home through a fog light. My hands getting cold, long nights. Skin pale, black bar, we'll be alright. Set sail in the mist, keep it kid close. See the tribe going in, what we here for? Throwing down, let me hold a couple arrows. But a claim on my lane, let the string go. Now we know we don't have time, now to fight back. We don't have time now to fight back. Go. Let a man grow, let the land flow black. Get my kinfolk or the gold in the sap. All info deep, no sleep, better snap. I can sleep in a tree, but I'm still in the attack. Cause we in now. Boy, you better get a show when we throw down. Ghosts getting close, let me slow down. Whoa, gone looking for a throw now. Till we gone, if it's water in sight, then it's on now.
Before we get to our next guest, I got to invite you to take a moment to look at the BVIG merch. You can stop at themixmerch.com right now to check out what we have. Now, Destinee, who do we have coming up next?
Well, I'm glad you did that. And remember, guys, I told you we were going to bring this up again. So go check out that merch. But next, our guest is, well, we actually have two of them, and they're from On the Peril of Parrots. Welcoming to the stage, Chase Bethea and Glenn Henry.
Yo, so I was vibing on the tunes of that trailer until the spooky moment came in and took me out. I need to know more about it. Des, how did you feel?
I wasn't ready for that. Like, I was definitely vibing. Like, the music is so chill and relaxing, and then it was like, somebody might be watching you. And I wasn't prepared. I wasn't prepared to deal with that. But I want to know where this is going.
Yes. Thankfully, we have Chase Bethea and Glenn Henry with us here today to talk about On the Peril of Parrots. Chase, Glenn, hello.
Hi, how's it going?
Hey.
What's up? Glad that you guys could come on. Yeah. Always love to see more Black creatives doing their thing in the gaming industry. So thank you for coming on and spending some time with us.
Thanks for having us.
No problem.
Yes. Now, if you could please, and I'll, Glenn, we'll start with you. Do you mind sharing each of your roles on the team?
Okay, no problem. I'm the principal coder and artist behind the game. So I'm making the puzzles and making the things move up and down. And Chase, wanna go?
Yes, I am the composer and music designer, working along with Glenn to make it a little bit more interactive and dynamic with along the puzzles and keeping it chill, as you have heard.
Interactive and dynamic, you say. Now, this is a great segue to find out what that means for our game. And as we're jumping in here, I would love to hear about On the Peril of Parrots. What are we going to be getting into?
Well, On the Peril of Parrots, other than being a mouthful to say, is a puzzle narrative game, right? You take control of an AI and you're being run through all these tests as part of this big shadowy experiment. So yeah. Yeah, you need to solve all the puzzles.
I already messed up.
Somebody's watching you and they're going to be judging these decisions.
That's what's got me so nervous. I already messed up. Okay, we're just gonna keep going. Like, I didn't mess up. To be fair, I'm not very good at these puzzles, but don't everybody watch me play the game, please. Continue your conversation.
I was captivated by the puzzles because I'm in the background, kind of like solving it as well, going like, yeah, go that way. You're doing great. But also, yes, we need to know more about the game. We have two talented individuals here to explain it to us. Chase, you talked about dynamics, and I imagine that somewhat relates to the music, given your role on the team. Would you care to expand on some of those details?
Yeah, sure. So the focus of that music is going to serve is it for it to be as you're feeling stressful. Nice job, Des. As you're feeling stressful in terms of, give me a second. Sorry about that. So as you're feeling the stress of trying to solve the puzzle, in Glenn and I are working with a system where is it you're going to unlock different layers of the musical instruments as you continue through a subset of puzzles that you get through and different game mechanics that I don't want to spoil right now, and Glenn will be able to probably take over from there and share more details on.
Don't listen to me. I'm trying to trying to figure out which way. If I go that way, I'm get stuck, so I gotta go left, right? I already messed up.
It's already over.
All right. I was so close. Okay, we're gonna do it again. All right. Guys, listen, this is the most nerve-wracking I've ever been, like, in playing a game, because everybody's, like, just watching me, like, constantly, like, I know, because you've designed it, you're like, she already messed up, man. Like, look, I know I already messed up. Nobody watch me.
Nobody. No, I'm like, look away. Avert your eyes. We will stick to talking about these mechanics. You know, to that point, Glenn, what else can you tell us about this game? What sort of challenges are players going to be getting into?
All right, so the game itself is pretty simple, pretty straightforward. You're supposed to find a critical path for each of the puzzles, right? And what we have been trying to do is kind of just build out, like, different tiles, special tiles. You might have seen some in the trailer that kind of flip the script on the challenge. So some of them will do things like flip the color that you are. So it's kind of challenging you to change how you navigate the entire puzzle. Some of them are like locks and keys. That's a different way. But the idea is to kind of hit that sweet spot between like difficulty and zen, like, kind of thing. And that's one of the reasons why I reached out to Chase to kind of, I've worked with him on some previous projects, and I have confidence that he'll bring my vision to life, which is this chill experience, is slightly zen, but at the same time slightly frustrating,
he says.
And yeah, watching people play is like a thrill, like, because, like, even though I designed the puzzles, and Chase and I, like, have gone back and forth on a couple of them, seeing people find these new solutions is, like, great. Because even I don't want to give too much of a hint, but even that Dez here is solving it. I'm like, this is really interesting.
I am trying.
You're doing well. You're doing well.
It appears to be going well.
No, I already know I messed up now.
But see, the cool thing about, I think what Glenn is talking about as well, is that so everyone solves it a little bit different. At least for me, when I'm playing and Glenn designed the puzzles, I discovered, at least doing about 3 run-throughs already of the entire game thus far of the demo, that there are at least 2 ways to solve it, at least that I've discovered. And so what I enjoy seeing when people play, and I think this is for anything, is you learn how they're thinking and you're seeing them improve as it goes along. And so what we're seeing here is the improvement, and rather than some people who just fly through it right away. And that's also
so nice with the improvement. I'm just keeping it real. Getting worse and worse. You know, no, because, okay, let me tell you, like, I feel like this is how I feel like when I play like a game that you kind of have to play over and over again. I think like Cuphead, I'll give that as an example. Like the first couple of times I'm like, oh, I did pretty good. The more I play, the more I get frustrated, the more I mess up. So please, guys, when you play this game, don't look at it as like this is what's going to happen to you. This is a flaw in my personality. The more I play, the more I'm like,
Now, speaking of,
I'm just trying to find all kinds of ways to get through this. But go ahead.
Speaking of this balance of zen and frustration, how did you consider that when building a puzzle game and yeah, how did you iterate on challenge? Yeah, I imagine the difficulty scale goes up as you start to accomplish more levels.
Yeah, so the idea is as you progress, you unlock new tiles and they add to the challenge. But like building an experience that was
yes, I knew you were gonna get that one.
Yeah, building on. Wow, I was like very much invested.
We all are. We're all invested in Dez's success.
But yeah, one of the tricks that we did was actually build out like a daily demo version of this, where it was just a daily diagnostic where we built the levels, we throw them up, and you can play like a level a day, and we just had that open to the public. And we use that to kind of get information on like the difficulty or how people feel about the game overall, and kind of use that as a guide for the puzzles that went into the, well, we are going into the final game. And yeah, that's how we did it. In terms of gauging things, it's really hard, at least for me. I'm not sure if Chase can echo this, but like after you solve a puzzle, it's hard to rank it again after you do it. Like, it's just now in the back of your head, so if you play it a couple times, it kind of just sticks and you lose the ability to gauge it properly. So yeah, that's one of the tricks we did to kind of get feedback, early feedback, and build and iterate on this.
The cool thing that I find interesting is like I can already tell when I messed up, like immediately, where like with most games you don't know, but like most of the time, even like if you see me keep playing, I'm like, I knew I already messed up. Like if you go back and watch this, you'll see my facial expressions and I'll be like, you know what I mean? So but like it is one of those games that I feel like can get really addictive, to where it's like you're not gonna let this game beat you and you have to keep playing until you get through it. At least that's how I feel about it. Like I'm just not going to let it beat me, but it's going to beat me like 32 times before I like actually get it. It's okay. It's all right. It's no big deal. I already messed up. All right.
This is really great. Now we have, I have to acknowledge the cool juxtaposition between the art style and the music. You know, starting with you, Glenn, could you tell us about what inspired the look of the game? And then Chase, I would love to hear what led you to choosing, say, this genre to go along with it.
Okay, so in terms of the look, wow, that's a long story. But So the game actually started as a game jam game in like 2018. It was a global game jam. I was site organizer for the Jamaica global game jam chapter. Spun it up. It was a simple critical path puzzle, and for the longest time, couldn't land on like a theme around it. Felt like a solid game. People liked the idea of it, but like accompanying it with a theme and something that, you know, could really resonate with people was hard. So kind of just kept it in my back pocket, and then stumbled, and this might be super nerdy, so apologies, but I stumbled across a paper by Dr. Timnit Gebru.
You got this.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Don't do it.
Yeah, a paper by Dr. Timnit Gebru called "On the Dangers of Stochastic Parrots," which was about AI and the dangers of or the concerns around training AI, large language models, on too large of a data set. And now that name stuck with me and the idea stuck with me, and I kind of just percolated in the back of my head to say, okay, let's make this an AI aesthetic. Let's make this kind of a retro futuristic vibe, right? And yeah, that's where this entire screen, the glow effects, the neon colors, all of that came from, just kind of building on that over time, slowly and surely.
Excellent.
As for the audio, I'll leave that over to Chase. Like, I just kind of gave him a theme, and he just works his magic. He did that in one go.
I got that one without messing up.
Let's go. See?
Yeah. Pretty excited. Look, I'm so into this game, I'm not asking any questions, and I feel really bad. So, and I'm also not concentrating on what's being asked, so I don't want to ask the same thing over and over again, because this game takes a lot of concentration. Mm-hmm. But one of the things I wanted to ask, like, I know you talked a little bit about the aesthetic, and that, like, this was, like, one of those... what was it called? Game jams? Am I saying that right? Game jams. Yeah. And we've seen so many games that, like, have started out that way and have come, like, full circle into, like this puts me on the vibe of, like, when you play Tetris or something like that. Yeah. Like, a game that you play, like, over and over, but, like, has a high replayable value to it. Was that your goal when you first decided to, like, go with this theme of game? Were you like, I want people to be able to play this, like, over and over again, just because of the challenge that I put in it?
No, that wasn't it wasn't the thought, right? There actually is an aspect of replayability around, like, the story aspects, which I think you're gonna hit on a beat in, like, one more puzzle, not something like that.
Okay.
But the challenge itself was kind of incidental. It's just because of the systems we built up for the jam, and how quickly we could turn out the puzzles, and the entire idea just kind of lent itself to that, like, just turn around, spin up mode. Like, you can just build puzzles really quickly and play them, play test them. Yeah. So it's easier for us to make a lot of content versus, you know, prioritizing replayability.
Yeah.
In this way.
That's actually pretty smart. Yeah.
Chase, there were some things that you're about to share about some of the music aspects, and I'm really interested how that came together, you know, with the theme here.
Yeah, absolutely. So Glenn gave me a theme, and he said, hey, working on this type of game, and I would like Bossa Nova. And I said, what? And I lost my mind, because I grew up with that music actually a lot in my childhood, and it's one of my favorite genres. And so too, throughout the years of working in the industry, I've subtly put bossa nova type of tracks in different games that I've scored, but to do an entire soundtrack was very exciting. A lot of pressure, because there's legends that I know of that I listen to, and that I know are the standards even of what that style is and what everybody typically feels that vibe is. And so being a video game composer, I always feel, especially with how I write, that I always need to push it a little bit above. So that style, for a little bit of history, is about the late 60s, early 70s of what everyone's typically familiar with Antonio Carlos Jobim or Stan Getz and Astrid Gilberto and a couple others. And so I also am trying to pay homage to that style, but also bring it into a little bit of this era too, a tiny bit. So I'm probably using some instruments that typically wouldn't be in the genre to be set, but as long as the texture is good, I'm kind of getting away with it, and I'm very happy, and a lot of people seem to be enjoying it, and so that makes me very, very happy as well.
Chase, Glenn, it has been a pleasure to spend time with you today and learn about On the Peril of Parrots. Before you're out of here, could you please tell everybody watching where they can find this game, where to get it?
Well, the game is on Steam right now. We're just coming up to the next best. So plug that in, you can find it. If you want to find out more about the game, when it releases, you can follow me on Sprite Wrench. All right, a sprite like the soda, wrench like the tool. Chase?
Yep, and if you want to find out more about me, I'm pretty active on Twitter, and it's at Chase Bethea. And if the soundtrack's actually on pre-order at chasebethea.bandcamp.com, so you can tie in their wish list and check out the pre-order if you're enjoying the music outside of the game.
Excellent. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for sharing that with us. And we will definitely be following you and following more about the game. When you said Sprite, I got so thirsty. Like, legit. Definitely. I was like, geez, what? I would love a Sprite right now. But thank you guys for taking some time out of your day to come on and be a part of Black Voices in Gaming, where we continuously uplift Black creators in the gaming industry. So
yes.
Thank you. Thank you. I loved your game. I am going to beat it. As soon as we get off of here, I'm going to go practice. Yeah. And then I'm going to like hit you up and tell you how far I got. So, yeah.
There you go. I love it. You know, you see, now that you said Sprite and you brought up being thirsty, I have no doubts that every other Black audience member is feeling the same vibe. I got hit with it too, now that you put that context in the frame. But getting to spend valuable time with developers and learn from them is incredible. If you're interested in supporting these developers, absolutely consider checking out our Black Voices in Gaming Steam page to wishlist the titles and more. From the ones that we've seen here, as well as others. Additionally, if you want to find another way to support our developers, consider donating to our Tiltify. Donations to Black Voices in Gaming goes towards our mission to help game developers succeed.
Absolutely, and we are all about seeing the success of those who want to succeed and put in the work. And like everybody who's been a part of these shows from the past up till now have done such an incredible job. We are so, so proud of you here at Black Voices in Gaming. But guys, we're not done. We still have more to show. Next up is Super Space Club by the wonderful and creative developer Graham Reed. So let's jump into it. Let's watch that trailer.
Stars are just the stars. Why don't we run away?
Sometimes I wanna run away. I for take time on away. A little place that we can hide. A little space to ease my mind.
Yo, that was Super Space Club by developer Graham Reed. Listen, I absolutely loved it. The music was so chill. And this is kind of like a lo-fi arcade space shooter, and I'm excited for it. I can't wait to get my hands on it. Derrick, what did you think?
I'm right there with you. I'm vibing with the music, and I'm just looking forward to playing it.
Well, you know what? Let's find out more about the development of this game. We have with us our special guest, Graham. Graham, are you there?
Yo, what's good? What's good? Thanks for having me.
What's up? Welcome to Black Voices in Gaming. I'm so happy that you could come on the show, show us your game. Yes. I love that kind of excitement. So, Graham, can you tell our guests a little bit, well, our viewers, a little bit more about you and what made you decide to make this type of game and what influenced you?
Yeah, of course. So, my name is Graham Reed. I'm from Kingston, Jamaica, and I currently live in New York. But I moved up here, in 2012 or so, and I've been here ever since. But about the game, I just really have a passion for making games, but it's just me as a solo developer. And so I figured something in the vein of Super Space Club, in the vein of Asteroids, Star Fox kind of vibes, was something that I could actually pull off. So yeah, that's just how I ended up here.
That's incredible, especially since you're a solo developer. I can't put two strings of what's it called when you're scripting? Yeah, script together. So see, I couldn't even do it. So I'm always in awe of people who are like, yeah, I did this game by myself. But I think we're gonna jump right into the game. Listen, this is me trying to play a shooter because I'm pretty terrible at this. So please just bear with me. And I'm gonna throw the mic over to my wonderful co-host so he can ask you some questions as I figure out how to not die. Thank you.
You know we got you for the moral support, but while Dez is jumping in, Graham, you mentioned being a solo developer, and I would love to hear just what was that journey getting into game development?
Yo, the journey has been a tricky one. It's been really fun though. I can't even lie. It's been really fun. I started with two other friends from Jamaica back in college. And it went from me thinking that, game dev is only for these big companies, the Nintendos, the Sonys, all those companies, to, you can have access to Unity. And at that time, we used an engine called Corona, which, funny enough. And yeah, four of us made a game, and it was sick. And so since then, I downloaded Unity, made it a whole thing. I made a World Cup Pong game. I call it World Cup Pong, so cheesy. And since then, I was like, all right, cool, bet. I'm just going to start making games now. Because it went from me being an avid gamer my whole life to, no, I can actually be the one making the games and giving everybody the vibes, the experiences, just something to enjoy in their lives, you know?
Certainly.
It's been really hard, though, because I've been, up until 2021, I've been doing it nights and weekends after whatever day job I had at the time. So that's been really hard. But no, it's fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for sharing it.
I'm trying to defend the universe, guys.
I see.
My energy is critical already. I already told you. Okay.
Graham, when it comes to Super Space Club, can you tell us the premise of the game and what was behind it?
Of course. So the premise is essentially you play as one of five anthropomorphic heroes, and you're trying to defend the galaxy against all evil. And yeah, you're just vibing out. All the music that you hear in the game is actually what the pilots are hearing. So you're just vibing out, chilling while you're defending the galaxy. So it's very hectic, but also it's a really zen-like experience. Destiny.
This is zen, and I'm like, oh my god, they're like all after me.
I was wondering if you're having the same zone,
that's it.
That's true.
Of course, Asteroids is a big inspiration for it. But in this, you don't actually get hurt by the Asteroids at all. It's just more of an aesthetic choice. I really liked how in Asteroids you just thrust, and whichever direction you're going in, you're facing, that's the direction you go. And the physics gameplay of it, to me, just really interesting to make and also to play. I wanted to make something that was fun to pick up and play within the first 5 seconds of you diving in.
Yeah, no, it is fun. I'm just really bad, and I don't want to die and have everybody watch me explode into a million pieces. One of the questions I wanted to ask is the color scheme. It's very, like, even though the game is like very chill with the music and everything, I know I'm not conveying that very well, guys, but it is very chill with like the music, but like with the color scheme, that's also very like calming. Like, did you do that on purpose? Oh, we're on wave two. Oh my God, that means I survived wave one. Okay, sorry, keep
yes,
going.
You did. So it's funny, when I first started making it, it was all black and white just because my previous game was very colorful. I wanted to try something new. And then I watched Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse and I was like, nah, this needs to be super colorful.
Nice.
And so after that, I just put all the colors, just made it very vibrant. And I mean, I think space should be more colorful, you know, like dark black and white space is so overdone. Like, I don't think anything is out there that looks like this, that has this kind of vibe to it visually and musically. So that's how the colors came to be.
No, I absolutely love it. And then you, y'all missed. When you were talking about Enter the Spider-Verse, I was like, yes, that's my stuff. I love that movie. It's so well done. And I love things that are colorful, good. And I'm so really glad. Yeah, it's so good. Listen, we need a lot more black superheroes. That's not what we're here to talk about, but it's the same. I absolutely love this. I'm going to die. It's hard to ask questions won't. And also live and survive, you know? Let me collect this stardust because I keep forgetting it. I just wanted to say that, like, I'm a huge like art fan, right? And so like my whole thing is like when I see a game, like the first thing that gets me excited is the aesthetic. But with your game, mm-hmm. like it's the aesthetic, it's also the music. And so I wanted to ask you more about the music. Like, what went into creating the vibe with that? Is that more like, kind of like, you know, I wanted to put some of my culture into it? Because even though the music is like a very chill vibe, from the trailer, you can tell like there's a lot of influence from like your culture into it. And I thought that was really dope.
Yeah, definitely. With the music specifically, I really wanted a lo-fi hip-hop kind of vibe. And it's so funny because when I first started working on the game, that wasn't really as popular as it is now. So to me, that was like a fresh new thing. And then everybody got on this lo-fi train. But I think what makes it stand out still is that every track in the game has vocals to it. And I tried to keep it with different black hip-hop artists. I have a Jamaican reggae artist. That's what you saw in the trailer. Or heard in the trailer, rather. And then I even have this one track with a French rapper on it, and she's sick. Her track is one of my favorite tracks.
Oh, that's so dope.
That's really cool.
Yeah. You are going to release the soundtrack, right?
Yeah, of course. That's my favorite part of the game. There's no way I couldn't.
I love that. Yeah, I want to pick up the soundtrack.
Mm-hmm. Shout out to Fat Bard
and the game. And the game as well.
The beautiful music.
Like, I'm just glad I haven't died yet. Because I just knew I was like not gonna make it.
You came in with these doubts and you're doing just fine.
Just fine, yeah. Like,
I'm really proud of myself, guys. Because you know, a lot of people. The demo's currently out,
and I've watched people play, and people die lot faster than you. So you're doing very well, yeah.
Thank you. I'm good at running away.
Wave three? Some people don't even pass wave one. What are you talking about?
Oh, it's because I'm good at running away. For real.
Well, there you go. So it's your strategy founded.
Yeah.
You know, I'm curious with the time that we have together, I'm curious, were there any challenges that came along through development?
Yes.
Just yes.
Yep. Challenges.
There were challenges.
No. Honestly, the biggest challenge was when I didn't have a day job. It was very hard for me to actually leave my 9-to-5, come home, and then put another how much ever I was into this because I didn't work a job like. So, finally, there you go. You made it. Wow. I never worked a job where I didn't have to care. Like, I actually cared about what I did. I used to work at Snapchat. And so I actually cared about designing and stuff there. But when I'd come home, it's very hard to go back on the computer and sit down for another 2-3 hours.
Yeah.
And so it was hard to do that. Yeah. But then the pandemic hits, and then all the Black Lives stuff hits. And I was just burnt out. I was so burnt out. And then I had a son. And in the middle of all of that, having a black son is just, it was rough. It was rough. Yeah. So
especially if we want to talk about the whole reason why black voices came into like existence was because of the thing that happened with George Floyd, and being a black male in America is stressful. And I don't think a lot of people realize that who are like outside of our community, but like thinking about having children and having black sons, that's really important. So I'm glad that you brought that up, especially when you're trying to be creative and you also have a daytime job and you also have a family. Look, I'm super proud of you. Like, this game is incredible, and you've done such an amazing job by like bringing it full force. Like, I don't know what else to say. I think you did a really great job.
I agree. Thank you. It creates like a really positive outlook on the future of development and the future of black voices in games. So shout outs to you being a part of
One of my goals, and I'm trying to set a good example for people like me, especially in Jamaica or all over the world, who just didn't know that this could be a thing.
Awesome. Well, we're almost at the end of our time. If people want to find out more about you, where can they look you up?
You can look me up at Graham of Legend on everything. Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, if that's a thing you want to look up, anywhere. Just look up Graham of Legend and go to superspaceclub.com. You can wishlist the game now and you can go play the demo.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. Remember to wishlist these games. They are so, so important. It lets Steam know that, hey, this is up and coming and it's popping. So if you like any of the games that you see on here, if you loved any of them and they're not available yet, please wishlist them. We appreciate it. And Graham, thank you so much for taking time out of your day
for
coming
me.
On
thank
and
you.
Talking with us.
Thank you, Graham. It was great to see you.
That was great. I'm so glad. Listen, I made it to the third wave. I'm pretty excited about that.
So that means when you pick up the game, we're not going to say I'm going to die a whole bunch, because we're actually just
going to
beat the wave. We're
going to get to wave 5,000. I'm going to be a professional pro at all of them. At all of them.
Exactly.
You saw that? That was fun. That was really good. Especially for a game that like I've never really played that type of game. So I'm feeling very pumped that I got that far. And I will be wishlisting it. And I can't wait for the soundtrack to come out, because I'm going to be playing that even when I'm not playing the game.
Yes, absolutely. I can't wait. I challenge you that when the game comes out, we see which wave we get to, how far we can get in these waves. Because if I remember in that trailer, it gets to a pretty high number. So,
Okay, bet. You're on.
This has been an incredible show. To be able to speak with all the devs, to see these trailers, I'm excited, and I've been adding everything to my wish list. Destinee, how about you?
I've been adding everything to my wish list. Like, I don't just say things, I'm about it, right? So I definitely added things to my wish list, and I hope you guys did too. Because, I mean, we've said like a million times, it helps the developers.
It does. But before we're done for the day, we'd like to give another shout out to our partners for this showcase. I want to give an acknowledgement to our silver sponsors, and that includes PlayStation. Look, I was raised on PlayStation, and Final Fantasy IX is still one of my favorites. ID at Xbox. Xbox is my jam, and I'm out here playing Forza nonstop. And lastly, Riot. Have you seen Arcane? If you haven't, you should probably tap in. Our other sponsors include Raw Fury, who helped get this series started. It's without their support that Black Voices in Gaming would have not accelerated from just a program to now a nonprofit organization. Razer, for all the laptops and resources that have helped support our developers. And lastly, Wilson Sonsini, the legal firm who's getting into the action when it comes to video games. We'd also like to say thanks to Amazon for the support during Black History Month and the celebration of Black game developers through their Prime Gaming Bundle and the games of that month. Along with that, we'd have to say thanks to Humble Bundle, who continues to support us and the devs. We really appreciate y'all. To help celebrate Black History Month, they've put together a collection of games called the Black Creators and Characters Game Bundle. It's incredible, and if you're familiar with Waking Unity Games, you might see something on there. That's a shout out to Amazon Prime Bundle and the Humble Bundle. Make sure to grab that phone, snag those QR codes while you can. Lastly, we have our broadcasting partners. That's a special thanks to Twitch Gaming, IGN, Steam, GameSpot, and GameJolt.
Awesome. And I heard something about Waking Oni and their game. So guys, definitely go check that out, because the person right over here, I don't know which way he is, he's the one who created that game. So make sure you... Shameless plug.
It's on the Prime Gaming bundle. Prime Gaming bundle.
Right? The Prime. Prime. But before we completely end and wrap this up, don't forget to check out the Mix event page on Steam, where you can learn more about the BVIG titles, buy the available games, and or add them to your wish list. Wishlists help the devs a ton, so be sure you add the ones that you like. Also, one of the most amazing things about Black Voices in Gaming is that this has gone, which we've said before, it's gone from just a showcase to a nonprofit. And it's helping developers reach their dreams of creating and releasing their own games. If you'd like to help support some of the games you've seen today and in any of our other showcases, be sure to take a moment and donate to the Black Voices in Gaming's Tiltify. Remember, grab that phone so you can catch that QR code.
That's right. And if you're interested in supporting Black Voices in Gaming through some of our merch, or slide a t-shirt to one of your family members like I did, check out the Black Voices in Gaming merch website. If you'd like to keep up with the BVIG family, you can follow Black Voices in Gaming at BVIG Gaming on Twitter. That's BVI Gaming on Twitter. And then there's Black Voices in Gaming on IG and everywhere else. Check out blackvoicesingaming.org as well.
Listen, there was a lot of gamings and ands in there, and I think that was flawless. I just want to give you your props for that, because I probably would have messed that all up. But
I gave it my best shot.
No, you did an incredible job. Nobody could do it better, honestly. Guys, I just want to say thank you so much. We already said our thank yous to everyone who helped us put this together, but also let's just give a huge shout out to all the developers who were brave enough to come on and show us their games. I know that's not easy, and we're super proud of you. Keep doing the things that you're doing. The people that we have on BVIG never cease to amaze me with their creativity and hard work. It has been an absolute joy to get to talk to each one of them and share their incredible games, projects, and their journey. If you saw a game today that got you really excited, be sure to wishlist it. I'm gonna say that all day, every day. Make sure that you wishlist it. Follow those developers on their social media platforms, and also hit us up. Tell us what you thought. As always, it's been a blast. I loved hosting with you, Derrick. My name is Destinee, and you can find me at DNBC32 over at Twitter, or check me out over at Level One Gaming.
Destinee, it has been a joy to host this show with you and celebrate the games that have been seen here on Black Voices in Gaming. To become a nonprofit, we celebrated this and mentioned this once before, but it's an incredible journey for this show, and I'm excited to see what other developers, what new developers we have in store as we continue to support them. If you're interested in supporting Black Voices in Gaming, we've said it profusely, but we mean it when we say that providing donations through Tiltify or wishlisting these games is the best way that you can support these developers. It's an important way to get these games seen and heard, and that's the entire mission behind Black Voices in Gaming. My name is Derrick Fields, and if you're looking to follow me, because I love rambling about PlayStation 2 games mostly, that's at Derrick V. Fields on Twitter and everything else on social media.
Oh my God. You know what? I think that's a wrap. Until next month, because we have another showcase coming in March. So guys, please stay tuned. We have lots more talent, and we're going to keep this thing going. Love you for loving us. And we'll check you out next time.
Thank you.